Hi there and welcome to another repair video. Today we're going to have a look at a board that I've been given from the arcade that's saying it's not working and it's resetting constantly. And the board is Return of the Jedi, which you can see over my shoulder. So let's see what we can find out about it. As you can see, I've got the board here up on the test rig. Got the loom plugged in and everything, and I'm set up to do some work on it. And this is obviously the first video from using the new workshop layout. So on the preview monitor, we've got Return of the Jedi, and as you can see, it keeps glitching. So hopefully, I can do this. I'm hoping I can do this without a soldering iron, because I'm pretty certain I know exactly what's going to problem. So I'm going to switch the switch on my test harness for a start off. We're going to try out the test mode to see exactly how good it is. And of course, I've done a little bit of this off camera prepping for it. And the test mode is telling us whether there's problems with it. And look what we see straight away. We have a ROM at D13, which apparently is bad. So what we're gonna do is lift out ROM D13 off the PCB and stick it into our EPROM reader and verify whether the EPROM is bad or good. And that will tell us which way to go, because if the EPROM turns out to be good, and that's saying bad, then it's something on the board that's stopping us talking to the chip. And if the ROM's bad, then we just reburn a new ROM with an image, and hopefully that will work and it should solve the problem. Right, so the EEPROM is now in the programmer reader thingamajig. I'm going to select 27128 because I've figured out what this is already by looking at the MIME drivers. So I'll select device, type in 27128. 27128, let's see, I think it's that for, it won't matter which one I want to actually read it with. Give it a second to boot the thing. Right, okay, so it's there ready to go. Look at the code window, we'll do a clear of the code window, fill that with nothing. So that's a blank EEPROM slate. I'm going to do a device read, so I click on read. And there we go, we get an EEPROM's worth of read into it. I'm going to save it out. This is from one of the previous repairs. I should really get Camtasia or something like that, some screen capture software. I'm going to create a file here on the desktop, Jedi, and this is 13D, Jedi 13D. Save. Okay, what I'm going to do on here is use my online ROM ident tool, which is hamsters, and we go back to desktop, pick Jedi from the, where is it, it's in my documents, yeah, Jedi 13D, and do a submit. Ah, there we go, and it can't match it. So that means the EEPROM itself is the problem in this case. So what we need to do is get another EEPROM and program it. Let's find an EEPROM from my pile. Okay, I've gone and looked in my trays, and I don't seem to have any 27128s. I have here though a 27256, which is double the size. This is a 32K EEPROM, and the one that's come off the board is a 16K EEPROM. 27128. What I can do is I can, they're the same pin out basically, apart from one pin. So on the 256, the pin up here, pin 27, is A14, and that doesn't have an A14, it just has a P underscore pin, which I haven't bothered reading the data sheet, but I know from experience that you can do this trick. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to use a 27256, but in order to write it, I have to double the image up. So the image on a 27C256 is 32K. So what we do is we pop that in the programmer like so, and we go back to our programming system. If the audio's crap on this video, when it turns out, it's because the tie clip mic that I'm using is refusing to stay in position on my t-shirt where it should live. So I'm just going to try and adjust it now and see if I can get it to stay in place a little bit better. Keeps trying to fall and turn over and stuff because obviously I've got the wire up my top and so on, like you do. Anyway, let's go back to here. So what I need to do now is go into device and find 27C2, stupid software, 27C256, like so, Let's see if we've got, if it's already got it. So what device type was this? It was an MB27256 or M something. Let me have a look on the EPROM. This was a M27C256. So M27C256, that's that one. Yep. Go select, like so. That will load up its profile for programming. Yep. What we do now is go to code and we go fill with nothing. And yep, to 7FFF, which is 32K, fill with FFs. And what we've got to do now is, I've already pre-downloaded the images that I need for this. So I open up a shell, and in my downloads folder on here, let's have a look, my documents, and in downloads, what I should find is I have a file called Jedi. There we go, Jedi.zip. So what I'll do is expand it, extract files, extract to Jedi. So that'll create me a folder called Jedi, which is probably at the bottom now. Yep, there it is. Okay, and the one I want is 13D. 13D, that's that file there. So go back into our programmer and we go open file. So file, open, finding the my document downloads folder here because it doesn't support drag and drop. Now I've extracted the file, all files. And I say 13D, wherever 13D happens to be, which is that one there. Got 13D, yep. And I go open. And what it's saying to me is, where do I want to load it? So this is a binary file, normal read mode, normal fill mode, and reads into location file offset 0000. Right, so I'm going to go there. That reads the ROM in. And what I'll do then is I'll scroll down here to, I think it's 4000, it's 4000, yep, there we go. So what we do now is we'll reload the exact same file, but at 4000. So I'll go file, because you have to double the image up, otherwise the programmer won't program the thing. So open, and double the image up, but instead of being there, go back here. Not 4000. Okay. Yep, there we go. We've now got binary data all the way down to 7FFF. Cool. And it's basically the same file repeated a few times. It seems relatively empty, actually, this is the file. Uh-huh. Okay, what have I done wrong? Oh, I see. It's not quite that clever. Let's try if we can go file open again. File open, that one, fill mode. What's the fill mode? So I've got option. Nope, read mode. Even byte or byte first. File format. Okay. At 00, so that proves that this software isn't quite as smart as I'd like it to be. So if I scroll down now, what I find is that when I get to 4000, I've got a blank again. Okay, so what we're gonna have to do is concatenate the file together ourselves in DOS, which is an old common trick. So I'm showing you that basically this programmer software is a bit pants for doing the job in hand. So let's open up DOS. There we go. If it's generous enough, it should let us have full screen, which it is doing. So do ./. Oh, let's see. Where am I? Oh yeah, there we go. My documents. Where's the backslash? There. Hmm. course, you have to do my documents to get spaces in Windows, don't you? Talk about make it as hard as possible. This is why I hate Windows. Yeah, maybe I've used the wrong shell. That's the problem. Yeah, that's better. That's better. My documents. Jedi. So I've got the 13D. Ah, that's my old file. I don't want that. Downloads. There it is. There's the folder. There's the 13D file. So I would have, all I would have done then, what an idiot, all I would have then done then is written the same ROM file back out and it still wouldn't have worked. So what I need to do is go start at 13D to show you that. That's the file I want. What you should be able to do is go copy 136030-123.13D and 136030-123.13D and 136030-123.13D to 13dconcat.bin. Do I have to put pluses in? Do you know it's so long since I've done this in DOS? There we go. So what I should have when I look in this folder is completely the wrong file size. What it seems to be is you need the slash B command, and you lot have been no doubt be shouting at the camera. So what I'm going to do is go copy slash B 136030-123.13D plus 136030-123.13D into, I'm going to call it 113dconcat.bin. Nope. That says, let's just say no for a start. No. And repeat our command. And it's saying, overwrite 13dconcat.bin. Yes, please. Thank you. Right. What I should have, if it's done it right, is I can have exactly a 32K file. So there's the original 13D16384, and now I have the concatenated version of it, 13D concat. So I'll come out of full screen mode, and we'll go back into our ROM burner, and we'll go edit clear. And I'm just doing this as belt and braces, edit clear, file, open, and in the right folder this time. So inside downloads, Jedi, do all files so I know I've got the right folder, and I should have 13dconcat. That's the one I want. Load it in at 0000. Read in. Okay, let's just scroll down the file real quick. Oh, we're at the bottom. So I'm going to scroll back up the file, and we have data the whole way through the file now. Hopefully, everything's plugged in, the ROM is in place, it's the right way round. What we'll do now is go back over to here and we'll do a blank check on the device, and it should come up chip is blank. That's correct. Go back to our code screen just to make sure it didn't wipe it out. Code, yep, we're all good there. We've got the device profile ready in over here, and as long as you can see what I'm doing on the screen, that's the main thing. If I now go right, hopefully everything should flash and dot and all the rest of it, because, and it should write the, yep, it is, it's doing, it's writing the chip. Writing again, and device is verified. Okay, so we take the chip out of the EPROM reader, and I'm going to pop it back in the board. Okay, chip's back in the board, and it's the right way around. I'm just double checking it, so I'll show you the board after if you want. And I've switched the test switch over to be in test mode automatically when I power it on. So we've written the ROM, we've verified the ROM. I'm going to switch it on. Oh, wrong one. Turn off. I thought I was already in test mode, so I'm going to turn back on again. There we go. So it'll come up garbage for a second. And then do ROM check. And now we have OK on all the ROMs. So I'll switch it out of test mode. And now it shouldn't reset. Press trigger to start. And now it's going a hell of a lot further because it's able to read all the game code. So there's a perfect repair. And a repair without the soldering iron as well, which is even better. So, right, okay, so for these people who like the quick fix version of it, that's the end of the video. For the people who like a more slightly in detail description of what we've done and a quick look at the board, stick around for a second. Right, so there is the Return of the Jedi PCB. And I'll just give you a quick tour. So the EPROM in question was this one here that we've written. And I can't really tell you too much about this board. It's 6502 based. It has the typical sort of Atari layout for 1984. It's single board and they put daughter cards onto it. Now this thing, I've never really looked into what it does. I need to read up on that. It seems to just be a daughter card that I've never known what it does. Over here, this is the interesting bit. What we have on this one is a quad Pokey expander card. What they did was the Pokey chip, as you've seen me talk about in other videos, is basically it's called a pot key. So it's an input output reader and it'll generate random numbers and it can do sound and a gajillion other things as well. And basically they ran out of quad, they wanted a quad based one for this particular game. And they ran out of quad Pokeys. So single chip versions of it. So they created this little daughter card that sits on the back of here and is just basically a drop-in replacement for it in case one of your Pokies fails, which obviously at some point, either this was a late manufactured board and they'd run out of them, or this is an early a repaired board and so on, but this is manufacturer spec. All the right tags are on it by the looks of things, so I'm guessing that this is one that's just purely either come from the factory or it's been it's been repaired back in the early in the mid 80s. So this is a 1984 game. It's all running absolutely smoothly now. Anyway, that's basically about it. That's about as much I can tell you about Return of the Jedi. So this will get, I'll stick a sticker now over the EEPROM. We know it works. Now for the other people talking about later repairs, this will still verify on the Fluke, by the way. And the reason for that is because even though we've doubled the EEPROM size and the pinouts are the same, the memory locations that you use are going to be identical. So I haven't really looked at the Fluke chart for it, for the virtual machine, which I'm just going to get up on the screen over here. You won't be able to see this because I just can't be bothered to move the camera again at the moment. I'm looking to get more cameras, by the way, to be able to do this and Camtasia and stuff like that. But 13D, so 123, 13D, 123, that should be at 10,000 to 13FF. Sorry, that can't be 6502 based then, can it? Or is it? Oh yeah, it says it's M6502. How the hell does it read that? Don't know. I'd have to investigate the 6502 because that looks out of, that's way past it. It must be bank switching to get to that. It's got to be. Anyway, but the checksum for it of C2FA will still read so long as the Fluke can sit in the 6502 slot and see the rest of the board. So, you know what? It might be a nice little experiment. Shall we try that? Let's get the Fluke. Let's pop the Fluke on there on the 6502 pod and let's just verify that we can actually read that ROM location. Give me a sec. Right, we've got the Fluke plugged in and I just need to power the board on. Board's now on. I've got garbage on the screen. So, we'll do a ROM test. Now, I'm kind of not actually expecting this to work because of the memory location that's stated. So there's some bank switching going on. It's definitely outside the range of the 6502 CPU, and I'm not sure how you implement the bank switching. So the first thing I'm going to do is verify I've actually pulled the correct CPU out. So I've pulled out what I think is CPU 1. I'm going to verify its boot ROM, which one of its boot ROMs anyway. So I'll verify actually 13F. So there we go, ROM test. And this is C000, C000 to FFFF for 16K. and the signature is FBC8. So F, B, C, 8. It says it can't read that. Why can't it read that? Romerat 0000000. Right. I've got all the stuff's all powered on. Let's try to run UUT. It's running. It's the game. ROM test. Let's try again. C. No, not, not. 2. FFFF. Signature FBC8. Let's try that. FBC8. Ah, now it's happy. So I'll let that run. It's interesting, the game will actually pause whilst it does this. There we go. So it says it can read C1000 to FFFF. I'm going to give it a quick try. Can it read one? Oh, run test one. No, oh, sorry. 10000213FFF with a signature of C2FA. So C2FA. Can it read that? No, it doesn't like that. Illegal address, and there's no other data for it. There's going to be bank switching involved, which allows it to switch in that. And I'm not surprised either. I'm not even going to try and read 000 to 3FFF because the zero page RAM, which the 6502 requires. So anyway, I'm going to call that a day on that one. It proves that we can actually interrogate the board to a certain extent. I'll have to figure out how to do, if there's any way to the bank switching in case anything on that particular EEPROM went wrong, or read the schematic. There's going to be some kind of latch or something in between the CPU and that, so that when the game code basically sets something, it'll put a bank switch in and it'll drop it somewhere else in memory. I don't know. I'm going to have to investigate that one a little bit. Okay, that's it for this video. Hope you've enjoyed it. As you can see up on the monitor behind me, the game's running properly still. I'm going to leave it on test for a little while. If you've enjoyed this video, please do click the old like button. A like down at the bottom gives us it goes a hell of a long way. If you're not subscribed and you've stumbled across this from a search for how to repair something, or just for the game name or the film name, and you like what we do, then give us a subscribe as well. Click the old button, and don't forget to ask it to be notified by email as well. Check us out on our social media, and if you want to ask us any particular questions about any game boards, one of the things we can't do is we can't do a video to order. I can only do a repair video for a situation that turns up. So if a particular board fails at the arcade, then I'm happy to take it in and look at it. If people send me a board that they want me to have a look at, a friend or something like that, or somebody contacts me in desperate need and needs some help and I can't help diagnose it remotely, yeah, I can do videos on that. But you can't just say, oh, can you show a video without a fix a steering wheel on something. When one fails, then we'll pull it apart and we'll probably do a video on it at the same time. So I know people have been asking quite a lot for very specific videos of how to's. If you're stuck on something, ask us a question, we'll try and help you. If you want us to try and, if you want to try and fix it, get in touch with me via Facebook or the website, and you can always mail it in. UK customers at the moment only, though, please. Well, UK and Europe only. I don't want to start dealing with international customs fees and things like that and getting things backwards and forwards across the Atlantic. There's tons of board repairers out on Clov, and there's also loads of repairers in the UK. I'm not an expert at this by any means yet, but people seem to be sort of picking up on things from the videos that we're doing, and I can recommend other people for very specific problems and if you need something done in a hurry, but don't be afraid to contact us. So that's it for this video. Also check out Ben's Retro Rambles, which is usually every Wednesday. He's been on hiatus for a week, and we've got more videos coming soon, so catch you next time.